I'm Flaminia Catteruccia. I'm Associate Professor at the Harvard TH Chan School of Public Health. And today I'm going to give a lecture on vector biology and the dynamics of malaria transmission. The lecture is divided in 5 chapters. In the first chapter, I'll talk about the complexity of mosquito biology and how that influences malaria transmission. In the second chapter, I'll look at the journey of the plasmodium parasites within the mosquito. In the third chapter, I'll introduce the concept of vectorial capacity, which is the interaction of the biological processes that are important for transmission. In chapter 4, I'll discuss current methods that are available for mosquito control, while in chapter 5, I'll discuss alternative strategies that might become available in the near future and might take us to malaria eradication. Let me start with chapter 1 and describe the complex mosquito biology and how that influences malaria transmission. Malaria is transmitted to humans exclusively by mosquitoes of the Anopheles genus. There are about 500 Anopheles species in the world. However, only 30 to 40 are considered important vectors of human malaria. These species are spread throughout the globe, as seen here in this slide, and they have very different behaviors during larval and adult stages. During larval development, which lasts about 7 to 10 days, mosquitoes are adapted to very different ecological habitats. Some mosquito species, for instance, prefer breeding in temporary breeding sites, such as those provided by rain puddles, while others would prefer breeding in permanent breeding sites, such as rice fields. Some mosquitoes are highly adapted to salt water and so live in coastal areas, while other mosquitoes can only survive in fresh water. These different ecological habitats expose mosquitoes to different environments, for instance, different temperature conditions and temperature shifts between day and night, also different microorganisms, predators, and nutritional reserves. In turn, the ecological habitats to which these mosquitoes are exposed as larvae will impact the physiology of adults emerging from those breeding sites, with possible consequences for malaria transmission. For instance, larvae that are adapted to temporary breeding sites might have reduced availability of nutrients and might have a shorter developmental time, so the adults emerging from those breeding sites will generally be smaller in size, and they might need to feed more often as adults on blood in order to meet the energetic demands of flying, mating, reproducing, and so on. This in turn might create more opportunities for plasmodium parasites for their own transmissions, because a mosquito that bites more often obviously will be more capable of transmitting malaria. Let's take a look at the mosquito life cycle, starting from male and female adults emerging from pupae. After emerging, males and females will have to find each other in order to mate so that the female can become inseminated with sperm transferred by the male. Then the female will have to go and look for a host for a blood meal. And after taking a blood meal, she will rest for a couple of days, during which time she will digest the blood components and incorporate them into the developing eggs. After developing the eggs, the female will use the sperm that she's received by the male to fertilize those eggs, and then she'll lay them in suitable oviposition sites. The eggs that are laid will then hatch into larvae, and the larvae will undergo 4 developmental stages before transforming into pupae, from where then male and female adults will emerge and the cycle will continue. Blood feeding is really an essential component in the mosquito life cycle, and is a step in which mosquitoes from different species exhibit quite a variety of behaviors. For instance, some mosquito species are highly adapted to feeding on humans, so they are highly anthropophilic, while other mosquito species predominantly feed on animals, such as birds, or cows, or rats. In order to transmit malaria to humans, mosquitoes will have to have a certain degree of anthropophilia because they will need to feed on humans at least twice. A first time, they'll have to bite a person that is infected with malaria parasites, and they'll ingest those parasites, and then after a few days, when sporogonic development is completed, then the mosquito will inject those parasites into the next human being. The propensity of a mosquito to feed on humans rather than animals can actually be measured, and this is the so-called human blood index. The human blood index can be measured by collecting mosquitoes in the field and looking at the content of their blood to see whether it's from animal or from human origin. This value goes from 0 to 1, with 0 being mosquitoes that feed exclusively on animals, so highly zoophilic, and 1 with mosquitoes that feed only on humans, so highly anthropophilic. As you can see in this map, there is high heterogeneity among mosquitoes for the human blood index. And many mosquito species with a high level of anthropophilia actually cluster in Africa. And these mosquitoes belong to mosquitoes of the Anopheles gambiae complex, such as Anopheles gambiae, Anopheles coluziae, but also Anopheles funestus, which is another very important vector of human malaria in Africa. Mosquitoes with a high level of anthropophilia are also found in Papua New Guinea, like Anopheles farauti, as well as in South America, even if to a lesser extent, like Anopheles darlingi. In any given area, there might be multiple Anopheles species that live in sympatry, and this might complicate control measures. For instance, let's have a look at Africa and at the Anopheles gambiae complex. This complex comprises 8 mosquito species that are morphologically identical and can only be distinguished at the molecular level. These species include some of the most important malaria vectors, such as Anopheles gambiae, Anopheles arabiensis, and Anopheles coluzii, as well as some more minor vectors, like Anopheles amerus and meras, which are adapted to coastal areas because they prefer breeding in salt water. Also, the complex includes some species that are not considered vectors of human malaria, such as Anopheles quadrangulatus, because they tend to bite predominantly on animals. If you look at the major malaria vectors, Anopheles gambiae and Anopheles coluzii, these until recently were believed to be the same species and just different molecular forms. Anopheles gambiae was previously known as Anopheles gambiae S form, while Anopheles coluzii was previously known as Anopheles gambiae M form. Anopheles gambiae and Anopheles coluzii have very similar biting behavior because they both tend to feed on humans and late at night and indoors. However, they show quite different ecological habitats during larval development. Anopheles gambiae tend to prefer living in temporary breeding sites such as rain puddles, while Anopheles coluzii prefer living in permanent breeding sites such as rice fields. We don't know yet whether these two species contribute differently to malaria transmission. Anopheles arabiensis is a third important malaria vector that shares habitats with Anopheles gambiae and Anopheles coluzii. Until recently, this mosquito species was not considered to be a very important vector for human malaria because these mosquitoes also feed on animals apart from humans, and so they dilute potential infectious bites. However, because of their plastic behavior and the fact that these mosquitoes can feed outdoors and rest outdoors apart from feeding and resting indoors, these mosquitoes become more difficult to be controlled with current vector control strategies. And so in recent years, they've become more and more relevant for malaria transmission. When multiple mosquito species live in sympatry, it becomes really difficult to understand their relative contribution to malaria transmission. This is well explained in this study by Fontenil et al., conducted in 1997 in a small village in Senegal called Yelmo. What the authors did, they looked at the relative contribution of three important malaria vectors, Anopheles gambiae, Anopheles arabiensis, and Anopheles funestus, over the course of 3 years. It is important to note that at that time, Anopheles gambiae were considered to be a single species, while now we know that those species contain both Anopheles gambiae and Anopheles coluzii. What the authors did, they collected mosquitoes from this village, and then they analyzed their salivary glands to look for the presence of sporozoites of Plasmodium falciparum. And after this analysis, what they could determine is that Anopheles gambiae mosquitoes were a very important vector in year one, while instead the contribution declined in year two and was negligible in year three. While Anopheles arabiensis had almost the opposite pattern, they were a negligible vector in year one, a little bit more important in year two, and much more relevant in year three. While Anopheles funestus had a sort of an intermediate pattern, and they were an important vector in year one, also during the dry season because these mosquitoes are better adapted to drier conditions, they sort of disappeared during year two and they came back strongly in year three. This study is a good example of the complexity of malaria transmission, even in a small village and prior to any vector control intervention as it was back then, and also shows the importance of performing longitudinal studies across a number of years, looking at all possible mosquito species that might be contributing to malaria transmission.